Good day to you. Allow me to introduce myself. I am a gentleman of limited means, but much ambition, as you will shortly discover. My name is Tristram Shandy, and over the coming days, I intend to give such an account of my life and opinions as will make no little noise in this world. Now, you must understand that this is no small task. Why, if I contemplate the number of accounts I have now to reconcile, the anecdotes to pick up, stories to weave in, and personages to call upon, in short, there is no end to them. However, I hope that, as you proceed further with me, you will come to know me, and our slight acquaintance will grow into familiarity, and perhaps even friendship. So, to begin. The theme, please. I was born on the 5th day of November, 1718, here in this house, Shandy Hall, in the county of Yorkshire, where I still reside. No, this troubles me. I cannot proceed by simple steps. To understand fully how I came to be born, and I confess to be the continual sport of what the world calls fortune, I must go back further. Yes, 9 months further, in truth, to the moment when my father and mother were, if you'll excuse the indelicacy, engaged in the business of propagation. For in this, I perceive, lies the key to everything that followed. Oh, I wish either of them, or indeed both, as they were in duty equally bound to it, had minded what they were about when they begot me. You have all, I dare say, heard of the animal spirits, as how they are transfused from father to son, etc., etc. Well, you may take my word that 9 parts in 10 of a man's successes and miscarriages in this world depend upon the different tracks and trains you put them into. And so, an interruption at a vital moment can be the root cause of later disasters. As it has proved for me.
Pray, my dear husband, have you not forgot to wind up the clock?
Oh, God! Did ever woman, since the creation of the world, interrupt a man with such a silly question?
You can see, sir, madam, my mother's question was a very untimely one, at best. Now, you may feel that the moment of conception is an uncommonly odd place at which to start an account of my life. After all, I was hardly present to witness it. Well, I warn you now that in telling my life and opinions, I will not confine myself to any man's rules that ever lived. So, please, come with me into the house, those who wish to. And shut the door. I was, as you have heard, begot in this house, in the night betwixt the first Sunday and the first Monday in the month of March, in the year of our Lord, 1718. And I am sure that I was, and that the moment of conception was, as you have heard, due to my being told it by my Uncle Toby, as I'll now show you.
But as the sagacious Locke states, our ideas link with others through association.
This is my father's voice.
Ideas always keep in company, and the one no sooner comes into the understanding, but its associate appears with it.
As he discourses on one of his favourite subjects, the association of ideas. Astride, as usual, a hobby horse of sound knowledge and vaulting speculation. Hold this for a moment.
Flight of fancy.
My father was, I believe, one of the most regular men in everything he did, whether 'twas a matter of business or a matter of amusement, that ever lived. In everything. As a small specimen of this extreme exactness of his, to which he was, in truth, a slave, he made it a rule for many years of his life, on the first Sunday night of every month, to wind up a large house clock, which we had standing in the master bedroom. And being somewhere between 50 and 60 years of age at the time, he had likewise gradually brought another little family duty to the same moment. You will understand my wish to be delicate. in order, as he would often say to my uncle, Captain Toby Shandy, a retired soldier who lived with us and was my father's great companion,
to get it out of the way at one time and be no more plagued and pestered with it the rest of the month.
Oh. What duty would this be, Brother Shandy?
A duty? An intercourse of a matrimonial kind.
Oh. Oh, I see.
Yet my poor Uncle Toby never really did see, being a man, as you will learn, of great natural innocence and decorum, and no doubt you, madam, are just as confused in your modesty. Well, it all comes down, as my father would say, to the association of ideas. My devoted mother could never be involved in the one duty, matrimonial, but she was reminded of the other, clockwise. Hence her most unfortunately timed question.
Pray, my dear husband, have you not forgot to wind up the clock?
Now, Uncle Toby learnt of the interruption because my father often complained about it to him, registering it as the first blow of many against my making a sound pathway in this world. And Uncle Toby later told me how, having one afternoon observed an oddity in the way that I, as a young child, set up my spinning top, my father shook his head and remarked,
"Toby, my heart has all along foretold that young Tristram will neither think nor act like any other man's child."
"Indeed, he is a very particular boy, brother."
"But alas, his misfortunes began 9 months before ever he came into the world."
Now, my mother, who was sitting by at the time, looked up. But still she knew no more than her backside what my father meant. Yet my uncle understood his melancholy meaning very well. And now, dear listeners, so do you. Although, I confess, it has taken me no little time to illustrate it. Now, open the door again. And step with me into the garden. I am aware that my history is proceeding unusually. I have informed you exactly when I was conceived. Yet I declare I have been discussing my history with you already. How long is it? 10 minutes. And I'm not yet born. I fear that this first episode may be ended before we have even reached my birth. Yet there are circumstances surrounding my arrival in the world which must be addressed before I can describe it. Well, a moment here in my arbour for you, and a little of my theme for your entertainment, I pray, while I attend to a pressing matter in my account. Now, enough of music. Here we are. It is, as I thought, upon looking into this document, my mother's marriage settlement, I had the good fortune to pop upon the very thing I wanted. And, as the article in it is so much more fully expressed in the deed itself than ever I can pretend to do it, it would be barbarity to take it out of the lawyer's hand.
"Walter Shandy, merchant, in consideration of the said intended marriage to be had between the said Walter Shandy and Elizabeth Molyneux aforesaid, I fully agree."
"No, no, no, stop! No, we have not time for all this. In short, after my father's retirement, my mother was, if pregnant, to lay in, if she chose it, in London. But there had previously, you see, been a false alarm. The whole journey to London undertaken on a phantom pregnancy, after which my father came back down with my mother into the country in but a pettish kind of a humour, determined not to face such expense and inconvenience again. What vexed him more than everything else was the provoking time of the year when this had happened, which was towards the end of September.
"Had I been whistled up to London upon a tomfool's errand in any other month of the whole year, I should not have said 3 words about it. But now, at the end of September, when my wall fruits and green gauges are just ready for pulling..."
"Is it Stamford or Stilton that we arrive at next, I wonder?"
"And that it should be a son that I have lost, having fully reckoned the child to be such, having gone so far as to have registered him as such in my pocketbook."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.